Alright, all you glorious gamers out there, welcome to the PlayersToo Podcast, the video game podcast for gamers like you, by gamers like you. You can find PlayersToo on all the social media, that's Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, the lot. You can also find our written content over at PlayersToo.com, that's PlayersToo.com. And if you could take 5 seconds to give us 5 stars over on Apple Podcasts, that really, really helps us out. It does a huge amount for the exposure of the show, and thank you so much to anyone that's already done that for us. While you're over there, you can leave us a little review as well, and if you let us know, we'll give you a shout out on social media. All right, and on with the show. My name is Mark Henderson. With me, as always, Mr. Lewis Camley. How's it going, Lewis?
It's going very well, Mark. How are you doing?
Not bad at all. What have you been playing?
More Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, which I spoke a little bit about last week. I'm a bit further in, although I am back on Zepho, because the structure of the game kind of takes you back to a planet, which I mentioned last week.
Yeah, Metroidvania, man.
Basically, yeah, that's what it's doing. And I am actually really enjoying it.
It's really good fun,
right? I think I was maybe a little down on it last week, and I was still getting to grips with it, and it definitely has its flaws, right? I'm not going to mask any of that. I spoke a lot about them last week. Traversal's got a little better, I think, and I have just unlocked Force Pull. That's more or less where I'm at. That should surely make particularly the rope issues.
Yeah, the ropes get a lot easier yeah. with Force Pull.
But I can't really put my finger on it. There's just something about the game that I'm really enjoying being in. I like being in those worlds. I'm getting better at the combat than I was last week. It's still not great, but I'm just really enjoying it. I kept thinking about it after I played it and kind of wanting to get back in, progress it. Story's like, it's not really overblown yet, but I can kind of feel the directions it's going. I'm okay with those. And yeah, just the combat, the traversal, the world that you're in, there's just something about it I'm enjoying. It's not a perfect game at all, but I'm there for it.
Do you know what I think? I think it's really satisfying to swing a lightsaber and for it to go zoom, and then for you to hit something.
Exactly.
I think that's really, really satisfying.
And when you can balance up that against the force powers, like there's a lot of sections recently where I've, you know, landed from a swing onto a big metal bridge and there's 4 or 5 stormtroopers around me and I throw 3 of them off the bridge instantly with a force push. And just moments like that, particularly when it is such a kind of almost a puzzle to work out, you know, who should I be facing? Often it's not actually the person who's running at you who's the biggest threat. It's the guy at the back who's shooting and you kind of need to duck out the way and get towards them or deflect their bullet just in time so that you can actually focus on the guy who is running at you. All of that stuff, when you get it right and you get through a kind of mini battle and you're still alive, that's a really good feeling. So yeah, if anyone is kind of swithering about playing it, well, neither of us have been big Souls people, particularly in the past. Yeah. And this definitely feels to me like kind of baby's first Souls game in a way, but yeah, it's got loads going for it, I would say.
It does. And what I would say as well is that if you are wanting that Souls-like experience, that brutal difficulty, that's there for you as well. I mean, I don't know what difficulty you're playing on, but I think there was at least 2 above where I was playing.
I'm playing on the second bottom one, yeah. Which
is normal. Yeah. So it's basically easy, normal, hard, and very hard.
Yeah.
But I mean, that very, very difficult experience is there for you with the Souls-style combat. It's just dressed up as a Star Wars game,
yeah,
which is awesome.
Basically, yeah. And also, as I mentioned last week, I've been playing Katana Zero. I haven't actually played much of that this past week, but the little bit that I did do was just absolutely phenomenal. I played through kind of 2 stages last night, and at the end of the second stage there was a kind of more typical canned boss fight than there had been in the rest of the game so far, and it just again had introduced something entirely new that the game hadn't done up till that point. I mentioned dialogue trees and stuff last week. It's not exactly trees, but there's little dialogue options, and they really played with that in interesting ways in the little bit that I played this week. I really, particularly for you Mark, I cannot recommend Katana Zero enough. The experience of actually playing it, like being on the sticks in that game and just dashing through a level and getting all your kills and getting out the other side, it is phenomenal. And yeah, that's about it. What have you been playing?
Well, I've finished Doom 2016, Lewis.
Nice one.
Now, apart from the fact that the final boss fight was a bit underwhelming.
Oh, really?
A bit. I'm being very nitpicky in terms of criticism. Other things I would criticise is the narrative. I just didn't really care about it at all.
Could you recount any of it to me if I asked you right now?
We were trying to close a portal or something, then there was a robot guy there. It doesn't matter. Yeah. None of it mattered. Yeah. The actual gameplay of that game is absolutely fucking brilliant. It was superb. I would highly recommend it to anyone who enjoys playing FPSs because it is really refreshing and really quite different, I felt anyway. And I absolutely cannot wait for Doom Eternal. If it's just more of the same, I would be over the moon. But it seems as if they're looking to take a next step forward as well, and I'm very excited to see what that looks like. I have also been playing a game that was recommended to me by our very own Lewis Camley, Card of Darkness.
Yes.
On Apple Arcade, Well, I'm addicted to it now.
Yes.
It's really, really good, man. It's really good. The setup is very simple. It's very easy to learn and difficult to master, yeah. which I think is exactly what they were probably going for. It gets surprisingly complex very, very quickly, and it's all dressed up like Adventure Time,
yeah.
which is awesome. I'm really, really enjoying it. I have absolutely blazed through the first maybe three stages or something like that to the point that I'm just behind you now.
Yeah, so I mean, basically I've been playing it, you know, a level here, a level there, you know, one on the train, one just before I go to bed or whatever. Yesterday I text you and you hadn't encountered a boss yet, which meant you were, I think, on the second sort of land.
To be completely fair, I was one level away from being a boss.
Fair enough, fair enough. But, and then I text you a few hours later and you were like right up my arse. You'd caught up so far.
I downloaded it 2 days ago. It's surprisingly difficult as well. Like, you end up having to do the same levels like over and over and over again because of the random nature of it. I do feel as if it just fucks you sometimes,
I
don't like that about games in general, just the random element and me feeling as if there was nothing I could possibly have done, although I'm sure there probably was. But the lack of feeling that you are in any control of what is actually going on sometimes annoys me, but again, I'm nitpicking there as well because by and large it is superb. Yeah. I'm really, really enjoying it.
I think without that you would breeze through the game too easily as well. Like, I agree, like the randomness is a pain and sometimes it feels like it gives you a buy as well. Like, sometimes you get a level and you just happen to not encounter any major enemies
you just,
or whatever.
You just run straight through the level, no problem at all. So again, it felt a wee bit like what I was complaining about with Ape Out, our play along game last month, was that sometimes I felt as though it was the easiest thing in the world and I just walked through a level.
Yeah.
And then sometimes I just felt as if, oh, this was just set up in such a way that this was going to be incredibly difficult for me regardless of what I'd done, and don't really like that element of it, but it's significantly less prevalent in Card of Darkness than it was in Ape Out for me anyway.
Yeah, and the rest of the game makes up for it, certainly. Yeah.
So I'm back on my Apple Arcade subscription. I will be downloading many further games, I think. I've beat my old Tetris score on EA Tetris, the only Tetris that matters. And now I'm calling it a day.
You're retiring.
I'm now calling it a day. It's been retired. So I am back on Apple Arcade. Sad to see Tetris go. He has betrayed me. But I'm glad I'm back on and playing kind of different games because it was just the one thing over and over and over again.
So much variety in Apple Arcade. I still think it's a really good offer. So
it really is. It's a great service. And excited to play something different. I'm feeling good about it. I'm feeling good about it now. All right, Lewis. And on to the news. All right, and news item number one. The coronavirus, Lewis. The coronavirus. It's causing a hell of a lot of people to pull out of PAX East and GDC. It has been nearly an exodus. Again, it feels a bit trivial to be talking about the impact of the coronavirus on the video games industry when literally thousands of people now have been killed and thousands more are infected. But this is the news, so here we are delivering it. So PAX East was due to take place February the 27th to March the 1st, and GDC 2020 was due to take place March the 16th to March the 20th. So far, PlayStation, Capcom, and Square Enix have all pulled out of PAX East, and PlayStation again, who kind of started this whole thing, EA, Facebook, and Kojima Productions have all pulled out of GDC. I mean, my heart really goes out to those people at PAX and at GDC who put on these amazing conferences for fans, and by all accounts they're really, really great, particularly the two of them. And I really think that a lot of people will be disappointed with the showing that's going to be there, if they even go ahead at this point. I mean, who knows? I know that they were probably under quite a lot of pressure just to cancel outright now.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And I'm sure that, again, a lot of fans as well, my heart goes out to them as well, because a lot of them will have already bought tickets to this, only to see all these major publishers just
stepping
up
away
and,
up
and leave.
And particularly with PAX East, which is due to start the day that this podcast comes out, as we record, that's a couple of days out, but like you say, it's kind of what has to happen in this situation.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think it is probably a safety first situation. Look, I know that there's been a lot of misinformation and, quite frankly, scaremongering around the coronavirus, but nonetheless, it has to be taken seriously. That's not to say that we should all be shutting ourselves indoors and wearing face masks all the time, but at the same time, like, in mass gatherings like this, as we're beginning to see outbreaks in other countries that aren't just China, I think that this stuff has to be taken pretty seriously, and you've got to respect these decisions by these publishers as well. I'm sure that this was not an easy decision by any means for them to make either, because they will also have had a lot of sunk cost into panels or whatever it is that they're doing. But yeah, it's rough and it's shit, and there's nothing really good to say about it, but unfortunately, it probably is the right call.
Yeah, I think particularly for the staff of those companies, that you are essentially asking someone to go to something where they could be at risk. You know, it's important to say both PAX and GDC are happening in the States, and there hasn't really been a major kind of outbreak or
there's not. I think there's 50 pretty well contained cases in America,
but obviously these are conferences that are going to bring people from all over the world, and as you said, I mean, even this afternoon I think they've announced outbreaks in like Switzerland and Austria and that kind of thing, so there's, it's starting to spread to way more countries. It's obviously quite big in Italy at the moment.
Iran is the other big one. South Korea as well.
South Korea being a really big one for this kind of sector as well. So like you say, it's shit, but it's for the best. It really doesn't matter that much that a gaming conference goes ahead as smoothly as possible when there's people's livelihoods and lives kind of potentially endangered.
All right, and news item number two then. A bit cheerier. There was an Animal Crossing Direct list.
Couldn't be much cheerier at all.
The most homely game in the world, I think, just about. The Direct went down really well with the fans. They showed off new progression system, a new sort of in-game currency thing that you can work towards, new crafting systems, updated multiplayer options. There was even sort of Minecraft elements where you could change your little island that you were given. All this seemed to go down very well with the fans. I am personally still utterly baffled why anyone likes Animal Crossing, quite frankly. But if you're out there and you do, good for you, and it looks as if this game is going to be right up your street. However, voice chat will still have to be done on Nintendo's dumb phone app, which is just ridiculous. It's kind of brought all this back to the surface again, just how ridiculous Nintendo's online system is. But the bigger concern, really, is that it was stated in the Direct that they would not be supporting cloud saves, which for a game like this, and Pokemon also doesn't support cloud saves, which is ridiculous and didn't really come up when Pokemon first came out because there was news on top of news on top of news at that point. It just wasn't something that we discussed, but I'm going to take this opportunity now to discuss how dumb this is.
Go for it.
It is incredibly stupid. Nintendo have subsequently come out and said that they would do it on like a one-time basis, basically, if the console was defective or lost, which means that they can do it. So why aren't they including that in your Nintendo online subscription when they advertise that that is part of your Nintendo online subscription? So if I'm paying my £20 to get, among other things, cloud saves and backups, then why aren't you including it in your games? This was part of your online ecosystem that you launched and you advertised that you would be giving us all. Why the fuck are you not putting it in your games? Why are you not making your games compatible with that? That's insane.
Yeah, particularly key titles like this in Pokemon, they're really, really major
Nintendo system sellers. Yeah. That brings me on to another point, right? So Pokemon had its own limited edition consoles. I don't know if they were limited edition, but it had its own consoles that they were punting. The Lite came out at that time as well, and there will be a Animal Crossing limited edition Switch as well. So they are also encouraging you to buy a new Switch. So if you bought your new copy of Animal Crossing and you decided, I'm an Animal Crossing super fan, I'll buy myself the limited edition Animal Crossing Switch. And that's great. You can go and play Animal Crossing on that. But you can't get your Pokemon fucking save off your old Switch, which means that you would be flicking between two Switches, theoretically, to play those two games. And I reckon the crossover and fandom between Pokemon and Animal Crossing is quite fucking large.
Probably quite high, yeah.
So I don't understand why you couldn't just get your save from one of your Switches that you own to another one of the Switches that you own. I don't understand why that's an issue for Nintendo. It's madness.
Yeah, I've absolutely no idea why. There is this kind of issue around, what is it, up to like four islands on your one console, so you can essentially, you and your family or whatever, can have separate profiles within the game, separate islands, separate characters, whatever. And it seems like that's what people are assuming is causing the difficulty, but like you said,
if that's causing difficulty, find a fucking solution to it. that's not a good enough excuse.
No, it isn't a good enough excuse, not at all. But you know, it's one of the things people are suggesting is the reason for this. But yeah, as you pointed out, they can recover your save and transfer it onto a new Switch in cases of damage or loss, you know, if you leave your Switch somewhere or whatever, which means that they have the capability of doing it. They've also said, sort of in the small, I think it was in the small text on the US version of the Direct,
yes,
not on the UK
not on
version.
The UK version, and they've since changed the US version to word it differently. The small print basically said all this before that we were just talking about, with that it'll be like a one-off thing. And that it would only be in cases where the Switch was broke or was stolen or whatever. But subsequently that's changed to say that there will be more details on this or whatever in the future. So I don't know if they're coming up with a different solution. But unless that different solution is, we will do this whenever you damn well ask us to, or we will back it up with cloud saves, and there is no other acceptable solution. I don't understand why this is a problem. It's ridiculous. Yep. And it's 2020, for fuck's sake.
Well, exactly. And like you say, they're asking people to pay money for this. It was one of the key features of the Switch Online service. So yeah, they ought to be doing it. It is kind of maddening that they're not. I love how irate it makes you particularly.
I have said on this podcast quite frequently that if they brought out a new Switch, a Switch Pro, mm-hmm. I would buy it, like, without hesitation. But that would mean leaving all my saves that didn't support cloud saves would be left behind on that Switch, and that would include Pokemon just now. That would be gone forever, and if I ever wanted to play Pokemon on my new shiny Switch, I would have to start again. Yeah. And then that would be that, and that's fucking bullshit.
Yep, pretty much, but that's Nintendo. Get used to it.
All right, news item number 3. Both Bethesda and Activision Blizzard have pulled their games off Nvidia's GeForce Now. We actually spoke about GeForce Now during our discussion on the streaming future of video games, and that Nvidia's GeForce Now had actually done quite well and was in beta for a long, long time, and that they just launched it as a product you could pay for. It allowed you to play games that you already owned on PC, on Steam, on Epic Game Store, on GOG, on Uplay, and on Battle.net up until, I assume, fairly recently. And when this happened, Nvidia made a couple of statements that we'll get Lewis to read, and then we'll just kind of frame the discussion around that, because I think that this is all a bit odd.
Yeah, so when Activision Blizzard's games were pulled, Nvidia said, "Activision Blizzard has been a fantastic partner during the GeForce Now beta, which we took to include the free trial period for our founders' membership. Recognizing the misunderstanding, we removed the games from our service with hope we can work with them to re-enable these and more in the future." And then when Bethesda's games were pulled later on, Nvidia added, "This trial is an important transitional period where gamers, developers and publishers can try the premium experience with minimal commitment while we continue to refine our offering. As we approach a paid service, some publishers may choose to remove games before the trial period ends. Ultimately, they maintain control over their content and decide whether the game you purchase includes streaming on GeForce Now."
So, the first statement there mentions that they think that the trial period, which is this period, which you do have to pay for, by the way, it's a fiver and it's also $5, mm-hmm. was within their trial period and within the period that they thought they had agreed with Activision Blizzard.
Yep.
Activision Blizzard seemed to disagree. But then they said in their second statement there that as they gear up towards a paid model, they already have a paid model. You have to pay for this. Like, this is no longer free. Yeah. It was free in the beta, it's not free now. So that's a disingenuous statement to me. I know that they are obviously looking to bump up the price of this eventually when they get all the kinks ironed out, mm-hmm. and whatever, and they're obviously doing this rollout in stages. But it sounds to me really as if they've started to make money off of streaming these big publishers' games, mm-hmm. and the big publishers were not happy about it and subsequently decided to revoke whatever license they had given Nvidia. Yeah. It just seems daft, because initially when this happened, but initially when I was reading headlines of Activision Blizzard,
yeah, so easy to blame them,
pulled their games from Nvidia's great new streaming service, I was just like, fuck them, those big corporate arseholes, yeah. and blah, blah, blah. It's just easy to dogpile on Activision, yeah, totally, at any given, yeah. opportunity. But in actual fact, I really don't think that Nvidia's legal team really has done their due diligence here.
No, or they've tried to be a bit sneaky about how they've worded things and thought they might get away with it.
And also, it's only become a problem when money started being involved, because yeah. all these games, both the Activision Blizzard games and the Bethesda games, were on the service during the beta. But now that money's being involved, that I think they're both looking like, well, how much are you paying us?
Yeah.
And whatever it is, obviously isn't enough.
I think that's it's a tricky issue, that, because, I mean, technically the player has already paid for the game, and so this is
this is getting into a whole DRM situation now, because although we have bought a license, mm-hmm. to play the game, we do not own the games. None of us own the games. See, this is, I think that gamers have to get a much more realistic outlook on what they are actually paying for when they buy a game, mm-hmm. because you don't own the game. You've effectively bought a license to play a game, mm-hmm. but you've bought a license to play a game on PlayStation or Xbox or Nintendo or Steam or Epic Game Store. It's not transferable unless they make it transferable.
Well, but yeah,
it would be like buying Call of Duty on PlayStation and then going over to your Xbox and being like, oh, why the fuck can't I play it here? It's like, well, you're on a different thing.
A lot of people do say that. Well, but yeah, and obviously all of that only applies to digital games, which is why physical ownership is still, you know, quite important.
In reality, it's not that much different. I mean, you can trade it in at the end of the day and you have something physical in your hand, but effectively it's a license to play the game.
Yeah, but they can't take it away from you, right? Unless it's a game where the servers can be shut down, a physical game copy can always be played as long as your machine still works, right?
Yeah, but for situations like this, obviously obviously that is
so that that
possible.
Changes things. Yeah, and you're totally right about the licensing thing that's going on there. I just look at it and think, well, if this big streaming future is to come, then I mean, this was a good example of it. This seemed to be, this allowed you to key into all the libraries you already had. You weren't having to do what Stadia were asking you to do, which was essentially to pay
rebuy the games.
Yeah, rebuy games and pay full price for them, or more than full price in some cases, more than you'd expect them to be retailed at. So it seemed like Nvidia had quite a good thing going. There'd been a lot of positive noises about how the technology worked. If it's just that the publishers have gone, hang on, you're now taking money and we're not getting a cut of that money, I can see that. I think that there's surely a deal that can be struck there, because
well, you would like to think so.
Yeah, because there's no real need for them to make any more money. They've made the same amount of money that they would have made had GeForce never existed. GeForce or yeah. Nvidia are just giving players options on where to play it.
And the problem is GeForce are now making money off their properties, yeah. And they're not happy about that. They don't want other people making money off their properties. They want to be the only people making money off their properties.
Yeah.
Or if other people are making money off their properties, then they have to have an appropriately sized cut,
which
I reckon is what's actually happened.
Yeah.
Because GeForce now is cheap as fuck and probably unsustainable at that price.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point, there's going to be a bump in price, probably double. I reckon about 10 or a month is probably about right. And maybe when you get to charging people that amount of money for your service, then you can afford to start doling out bigger cuts because you're still getting yours, you know what I mean? But I think at a fiver, just them rolling it out for a fiver just now was probably just so that they could cover themselves as they continued the development.
Yeah.
But because they were making money, that makes it quite difficult for all the publishers to turn a blind eye to that when they're effectively making money off their properties, which they wouldn't allow anyone else to do, you know?
Can
I just say it's kind of corporate bullshit, and I'm perfectly aware of that. And that is nonetheless the reality of the situation.
Yeah, it's just that thing about making money off of their properties, which I think is contentious, because arguably you've already bought the game on Steam. They've taken their cut. All of that's fine. This is simply a window into it. It's like saying we'll take a cut of the money that you spend on the PC that you've used to play it. I know it's not exactly that, obviously, but it worries me for this digital future, this all streaming, all dancing future that we keep getting promised, particularly by you.
It's coming.
For
better or worse, it's coming.
What is that price going to be to the player when... So this is two publishers that have pulled out over a fiver. You're saying maybe they'll charge around a tenner. We'll see. But if that then draws in every other major publisher, and every minor publisher for that matter, and every independent developer who all say, oh, we need our cut if you're going to do this, how can they possibly make that sustainable unless they charge us a fortune, and then the system, it won't survive, right?
That is kind of the problem with Nvidia's service, is that you don't buy games on that service, which is where they would be getting their cut, and then you would just be paying for the service on top of that. And I think that if Nvidia had opened their own store and were selling Overwatch or whatever for a decent price, and Activision Blizzard were getting their 70% cut or whatever it may be of the game sales, then you can fucking stream it. We don't care. We've got 70% of the sale of the game.
Mm-hmm.
However, when it's a service, it becomes a bit more tricky, because yes, someone's already bought that and has a license for it to play it on Steam, but then you're then taking that license and using it to stream over Nvidia's service. And I think that becomes quite complicated now, because you're then paying for Nvidia's service to run your Steam copy of Overwatch, say, and they're making money providing that service, but Activision Blizzard aren't, and I don't think they would be very happy about that.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that's not bullshit.
No,
but that is the situation.
Let me just pose a devil's advocate there, though. How does that differ from Stadia, on one hand, selling you the game, and then on the second hand, charging you for the service? Because, again, Activision Blizzard makes its money from Stadia selling you the game, right? But then they're also charging you for the service. So how does that differ from Steam selling you the game and GeForce charging you for the service?
Because it's not one entity.
Yeah, it seems to just be that, right?
I'm not going to pretend to know the ins and outs of this. But yeah, it's corporate and it's wank.
I think
it's not player-focused. And I thought Nvidia's service was very player-focused, and I really like that. Giving you access to all your libraries, obviously all the stores have agreed to this to allow them access to the games that they'd bought on there. All these publishers had agreed to let the gamer stream the games from these stores while it was in beta, but I think that suddenly money's now involved, then I think that that's basically complicating it, and I think that these publishers either don't think they're getting a big enough cut, or they're just not happy with others making money off their games when they're not, and that's the end of it. All right, news item number 4. In an article on Xbox.com, Phil Spencer has unveiled the specs for the Xbox Series X in glorious detail. The Xbox Series X will have a custom AMD Zen 2 processor with RDNA 2 architecture. Lovely. Sounds absolutely brilliant. It will have 12 teraflop GPU. Got to get those flops, mate. Got to get those flops. It will have something called variable rate shading, which seems to be prioritizing what pixels you're working on at any given moment with your graphics card, which actually sounds quite good. Yep. Apparently, this produces a more sustainable frame rate, and it will improve resolution, both of which I know are good things. It will also have hardware-accelerated DirectX ray tracing, SSD storage. It will have multi-game quick resume, which I think is cool, which is very, very cool. It will support 120 frames per second, and it will have four generations of gaming, which basically means it will be backwards compatible to the OG Xbox, all of which was basically not unexpected, I would say. I think all of this is within the realms of what we were expecting the specs of the next-gen consoles to be. From what I can gather, and I know I'm kind of taking the piss with flops and whatever, right, but I'm not technically minded in that I know how big a difference all these things make, but what I do know is that this is a significant step forward, even from the PlayStation Pro and the Xbox One X. This is a big move. However, there was an interesting IGN article comparing the specs to a modern gaming PC and how much it would cost me or you or anyone to go out and build a modern gaming PC to the specs of the Xbox Series X, and they seem to reckon that it would cost between $600 and $700. Considering that we're talking last week about these consoles being maybe between $450 or $500, it just shows you that the value for money that there is in consoles and why a lot of people choose to go for them. I mean, quite frankly, they just work a lot of the time, and quite often PC maintenance is not always ideal.
God, yeah, it's a second job sometimes making sure that your PC runs properly.
But I mean, see, if you're hardcore into your PC games, you love it. You love it when something goes wrong. You love buying a new graphics card. Oh, I've got a new motherboard.
And that's why you're all ill.
Nah, we love you all equally. We love you all equally. Also, comparing this to the Bloomberg article, which suggested that $470 would be a, quote, hard sell to gamers, I think that it just shines a light on how nonsense a statement that really was. And it also shows what the price of these things kind of really is, because we've been talking for months and months and months about how the consoles are basically becoming PCs. They're just pre-built PCs with their own operating system, basically. And to do this by yourself would cost you a hell of a lot more than actually just buying the console. The other interesting thing about this is what Phil Spencer called smart delivery. I will let Lewis read Phil Spencer's statement about it.
This technology empowers you to buy a game once and know that whether you're playing it on Xbox One or Xbox Series X, you're getting the right version of that game on whatever Xbox you're playing on. We're making the commitment to use smart delivery on all our exclusive Xbox Game Studios titles, including Halo Infinite, ensuring you only have to purchase a title once in order to play the best available version for whichever Xbox console they choose to play on. This technology is available for all developers and publishers, and they can choose to use it for titles that will be released on Xbox One first and come to Xbox Series X later.
So basically what that means, if you buy Halo Infinite on Xbox One and then later buy an Xbox Series X, then you'll effectively get a free upgrade to the Xbox Series X game, which is fucking really good.
Yeah.
That is excellent. And in fact, CD Projekt Red have confirmed that if you buy Cyberpunk on the Xbox One and then upgrade to a Series X, then you will get an upgraded version of Cyberpunk, which is really awesome.
Yeah.
I think that's really, really great.
That's really brilliant. It's amazing that CD Projekt Red came out and said that so quickly, almost kind of in tandem with a statement. But it puts a lot of pressure on the other major publishers and developers to sign up to this.
The way that it's worded as well by Spencer, he's worded it well here, and he's basically said, if you have to pay for X game on Xbox Series X again after you've already bought it on your Xbox One, that is not us. The publisher is making you do that.
Yep.
Because we have put in place a system whereby you don't have to do that, and they have elected not to use it. So I think that he was very clever in the way that he's said that. It'll be very, very interesting to see if PlayStation do a similar thing, quite frankly. That's what I'm thinking about.
Yeah.
Well, that's where I'm going to be.
As
I'm
a pair of PS ponies, yeah. I mean, yeah, that is where my mind went immediately as well. It feels to me like they absolutely have to do something like this.
Particularly for first party stuff.
For first party stuff, yeah. And as far as possible with third party stuff. Obviously, any third party developer or publisher who is doing this on Xbox is surely game to do it on PlayStation as long as they're thought, as long as they're thought, permitted to. So, you know, it's I think reasonable to assume the same deal for Cyberpunk on PlayStation, assuming PlayStation actually has the architecture to support that. But also, like, bear in mind, because I think when I first read all this earlier, and we've been talking about it kind of on and off, off air, and the one thing to kind of keep in mind is that this still probably only really affects more or less like tail end of 2019 and 2020 games, and maybe some 2021 games. This isn't something that's going to affect, you know, you're still going to get in future your RE4 remaster, I think, right? Assuming that ever comes. There's no reason to suspect that any company would just do this for a game that isn't essentially a cross-generation title, right?
Yeah. I think that it's to ease us into the next generation. Yeah. I don't think that 2 years down the line, when Matt Booty had said that exclusives might start coming out for the Series X, but up to that point, we have to assume that all Xbox exclusives, anyway, will also be on the Xbox One. So I don't know, in that situation, if you buy the Xbox One game, then you would get it on your Xbox Series X, because then you could sort of work the system a little bit there, couldn't you? Because if you had an Xbox Series X, you could buy the Xbox One version of the game, which presumably would be cheaper because it was the last gen game.
Yeah, maybe.
And then you could get a free upgrade to your Xbox Series X. So I don't really know how that would work.
I suspect,
that's quite interesting to think about. But I would have thought there would have been systems in place for that. I think you would have had to have owned the game prior to owning an Xbox Series X.
Possibly. I guess that it might just be that the Xbox, you know, online store, the prices for the two systems will be the same from now on. You know, your Xbox One version and your Xbox Series X version will be the same cost because...
But I'm talking about physical.
I mean. Yeah, well, physical's a whole other issue, because the other thing with physical releases is that, I mean, presumably for Series X games, you want a bigger disc size, right? You want 100 gigabyte discs or larger to contain the types of games we can get for them, but they won't be playable on the old generation. And so there was a suggestion, I was reading the Digital Foundry article on all of this earlier, which was really great because it talks about flops in a way that you can understand, and we'll link to it in the show notes.
Digital Foundry guys are good.
Yeah,
they're very good when it comes to the tech.
Really dive into the technology behind all of this stuff. But they were kind of making the point that, yeah, like a Series X game on a disc might by necessity have to be, you know, not the complete thing. It might by necessity need a patch to get it up to, essentially to install all the new things that the Series X can add to it, particularly graphically. So yeah, there's just issues there around how all of this backwards and forwards compatibility thing will work. I still think that basically that only really matters for like the first year or two of the console, because after that, things will just be released as they are and there won't be this. So for a game
I mean, ultimately developers are going to start developing only for the
exactly.
Consoles. Having said that, Xbox have still said that they will be supporting the Xbox One with all their exclusives for 2 years. So I don't know how it works with them, but I know that third parties will only want to be developing for as few systems as
exactly.
they possibly can.
But again, and does that mean they have to develop for the more limited specs of the Xbox One until that tipping point, you know? Do they have to still keep covering that, or can they just move on and forget about it and it's up to...
I think they'll be able to move on. I don't see what interest it would be of Microsoft's to hamstring the third parties that way. If they want to, with their own studios, continue to support the Xbox One with all that stuff, then great, fantastic. But I would struggle to see a world where the third parties would be okay with that, and that they would effectively be limiting themselves by having to develop for an older generation console. It's like death by the lowest common denominator,
exactly,
right?
Well, exactly, that's the problem,
as well. It would mean that PlayStation, who is their competitor, despite what Phil Spencer says, would always have better looking games all the time, because the discs would have to work in the Xbox One and the Xbox Series X, unless, again, like you were saying, the disc that you got, even though it said Xbox Series X on it, was effectively just an Xbox One game, and then you had to download the biggest patch in the world.
Yeah, all the new assets, all the things that you've bought a new console for, essentially.
Exactly, you had to download. I don't know how Xbox are going to get around it. I think it's great that they're doing this, though. I mean, I do think that it's genuinely really, really good, and I seriously hope that PlayStation respond positively to this and do the same thing. I also hope that a lot of the third-party developers take advantage of this as well and do elect to upgrade games, particularly as we're kind of crossing into the new generation. Not to say that this will be going on for years, but particularly over that particularly turbulent patch for everyone in the industry.
Yeah. Particularly with all the delays this year as well.
Exactly, and there could be loads and loads of game purchases happening at the back end of this year on current consoles for games that they might want to play 2 or 3 months later on
a new system.
On a new system. I really hope that the third parties do take advantage of that.
Do you think that's likely, though? So I just want to really quickly take like Ubisoft as an example, right? This year, they're releasing Watch Dogs Legion. They've also said Rainbow Six Siege is going to be supported on the new systems.
Yeah.
So do they charge for that game again? That's basically what I'm asking.
I don't know.
Do Watch Dogs Legion...
No idea. I wouldn't have thought for Rainbow Six Siege, I was kind of assuming no, actually. For Rainbow Six Quarantine...
I mean, that's
maybe.
Yeah, that's a maybe. But for Watch Dogs Legion as well, so that game comes out whenever.
Yeah,
then
on this generation.
On this generation. And then they are completely within their rights and probably within their budget forecast to resell you that game on a new system.
Yeah.
And unless Xbox can compensate them for that, or PlayStation or whatever, or unless they all just do it out of the goodness of their hearts when they could sell a second copy of that game.
Yeah.
I find it hard to imagine that they'll do that, although I think that they should, and I think they'll look bad if they don't.
I think that... if more and more publishers do this, the ones that don't will soon stand out. All right, and finishing off with a couple of shout-outs. Shout-out number one, a new update to the Switch version of The Witcher 3 has seriously improved the graphics and has enabled crossplay with PC. However, CD Projekt Red have confirmed that they have no plans for cross-save to other platforms, e.g. to other consoles, PS4 and Xbox, much to the chagrin of Lewis Camley.
Yeah, pretty much. I think, first of all, this is great. It sounds like a great update. And yeah, the cross-save with PC is superb. It effectively allows you to take a PC game on the go on your Switch, you know, more or less. But yeah, I would love to have that same experience, but with my PlayStation version, which I've, you know, sunk 30 or 40 hours into and then put down. And as soon as I heard there was a Switch version coming, I thought, perfect, this is the time I can play it on the go, I can come back, put it up on PlayStation, pick up from there, and they won't give me it.
All right, shout out number two. The DualShock 5 may modify user experience based on biofeedback. Now,
you've got a skeptical face on, Mark.
Now, this is weird. So this has all come from a recently filed patent. It seems that the controller will sense your heart rate and how sweaty your hands are, and modify your experience based on that. Now, I have some questions about this. One, what is it changing? And why is it taking that agency away from the player and giving it to my sweaty hands?
Well, technically your sweaty hands are still the player. Yeah,
my brain is the player.
I don't
my
really...
My hands are the brain still. Sorry, that was a bit existential there.
Yeah,
was...
took me somewhere different there. I can't see why someone would want that. What is going to change? Very minor changes in difficulty level,
I really do not know. Also, is this going to be a massive drain on the battery?
Yes.
Just immediately.
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah, listen to what it sounds like.
I know. And we already know that the PlayStation controller is going to be giving us haptic feedback, which sounded great. But the PS4 controller, one of the biggest problems with the PS4 controller is the horrible battery life because of that stupid light that they put in the back of it. And I just don't want that to happen again unnecessarily. So if this is an option or if this is a feature of the controller, I want to be able to turn it off, which I doubt they will let me do because they wouldn't let me turn off a fucking light.
Surely they've learned from the light bar scenario, though. Two possible things I can think that this would have use for is A, if they're planning some kind of fitness game, like the Ring Con on the Switch.
Right.
Which it doesn't feel like a Sony thing to do or to waste a lot of energy putting it into the handset.
A huge amount of development in that for one game or one series.
Like a couple of games,
That seems very unlikely.
It's not really something that people associate with PlayStation.
No.
The other thing is for VR, which I can see how a game could be adjusted there, or it could completely remove you from it if your heart is racing too fast or whatever.
Yeah,
you know?
maybe.
But that's about it.
Yeah, the other thing that I was thinking is how feckin' expensive is this controller going to be?
Very.
All right, shout out number three. According to Masahiro Sakurai himself, the Smash Brothers Ultimate Second Fighter Pass will be its last, Lewis. It will be its last. At the conclusion of the second Fighter Pass, the game will have 88 characters. Sakurai has also said that neither he nor Nintendo are thinking about the future of the franchise. I'm not really sure where the franchise goes after this anyway, to be completely honest.
No, yeah, it's hard to imagine what a next game is.
They called it Smash Brothers Ultimate, and I think that it has lived up to that title. Mm-hmm. It is the ultimate version of that game in a lot of ways. And I don't really know where they go from this. And I don't really think that he is very interested in continuing with the franchise.
Yeah.
He's spoken before about how like insanely overworked he is. And he's spoken a lot before about wanting to get away from the franchise because this has been his entire life, basically. And to be honest with you, I think if Smash Bros. Was your whole entire life, as great a game as it is, you might want to like shake it up every now and again, you know? Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, fair play to him. I think the guy's an absolute credit to the video games industry. I think he's made one of the best homages to video games in the world. Absolutely. In Smash Bros. Ultimate. Absolutely. And quite frankly, whatever that guy wants to do, fucking fair play to him.
Yeah, Nintendo are never going to let it go, though, so there'll be no, something.
Nintendo might not, yeah. But Sakurai, I think it might be without him. All right, shout out number four, Dangerous Driving Loose, the spiritual successor to the Burnout series. Burnout series, much beloved here at PlayersToo, big part of our childhoods, is getting an open world sequel, which sounds a lot like Burnout Paradise. So for those of you that don't know, Dangerous Driving came out, it was in every way a ripoff of the Burnout games, particularly Burnout 3 Takedown. It was kind of a more up-resed version of that. But basically, the game, I think, lacked quite a lot of that AAA polish that you would want.
Yeah.
However, it seems to have done well enough that they are willing to make a sequel for it. And they've gone open world, which I'm a bit skeptical about, considering the size of the studio. It's not Criterion that used to make the old Burnout games with the backing of EA. This is a small indie studio now with very few people, and open worlds can be very problematic. So I hope that they've not gone too big. But I think that I'm going to buy Dangerous Driving.
Yeah.
Because I always said when it came out that I would buy it, and I never did, because basically the reviews were a bit tepid at best. But in reality, I really, 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 really want a fucking new Burnout game.
Yeah.
And I would be willing to support three bad games to get one good one.
I think you're totally spot on there. Like, bear in mind, this was made by a lot of people who did work in the original Burnout games. This is essentially Criterion graduates.
Yeah, it completely is. It's people from the old Criterion studio that have subsequently left and created this new studio and are making Dangerous
but Dragon. There is a Burnout Paradise remaster out on this generation, which makes it hard to imagine how they can do this as well as that did. And also,
I don't know,
Criterion have just been handed the reins of Need for Speed again.
Yeah, but Criterion have been making crap Need for Speed for years. No, so
they weren't making it for the last few games though, and there's been a restructure and they're taking over again. So I just wonder if EA is going to try and make that type of game again, basically. But I hope you do buy Dangerous Driving. I would love a shot of it.
You can buy it.
You've said you're going to buy it live on air.
Yeah, apparently it was going to be shown at apparently it was going to be demoed at PAX East as well. I mean, hopefully if they still go, then people can get a shot of that and we can maybe get some feedback. But yeah, we all know about PAX East, don't we? All right, and shout out number five, Capcom has unveiled that there will be a demo for the RE3 remake. This will undoubtedly be the same format as the one-shot 30-minute demo that they did for the RE2 remake, which was great, which was really good. It was just like a small, short part of the game. We both played it. The game is coming out on April the 3rd, so I reckon this will probably be pretty soon, I would have thought, yeah.
They basically said details to come soon, so yeah, I would expect it in the next week or two.
Yeah, this actually only broke not that long ago at all.
Yeah.
Definitely going to play it.
Yeah, oh yeah, definitely give it a demo shot, yeah, and almost certainly getting RE3 when it does drop, yeah.
Yes.
I don't feel like I need a demo. I felt like a demo for RE2 was really good because it was like in a first vision of this remake, but
yeah,
I totally trust them now.
Yeah, I must admit, I do agree with that take. I think that the first one was very useful to show off what they were trying to accomplish with these remakes, but now that we've had a full game as that style of remake, I don't really feel as if I need this, but I mean,
I'll play it.
Yeah, I'll fucking take it, man. I'm not complaining. All right, and with that, time for a beer. And we are back with Topic of the Week. Topic of the week this week, Lewis, is video game conferences and kind of the marketing in general around video games and what conferences mean in 2020, really.
Yeah, so I guess this is kind of sparking off of two things. So obviously we spoke earlier in the show about GDC and PAX and the kind of challenges that they're facing just now, which are obviously all very connected to coronavirus, and there's no suggestion here that, you know, those shows in particular are under any danger or any scrutiny particularly. But we also have reported in the last few weeks about, you know, fairly significant major call-offs from E3 in particular.
Yeah.
And I guess I just wanted to kind of look at what is the purpose of these conferences just now. They all have slightly different remits. They all have slightly different kind of angles. They are trying to attract different people. I guess my question really to start all of this off is kind of like, what in 2020, like, what is the point of these conferences? Do we still need them? Do they still have a place in the marketing and the kind of cycles of video game releases?
Yes, I think that they do. I think that they should be for the fans, though. Mm-hmm. I think that that's really where the value lies. I don't think that there's a lot of value now in what E3 used to be, which was this major, major hype event that basically showed off to the gaming media what you were doing, what you were working on. But in this day and age with internet and with things like Twitch and YouTube and being able to instantly get your message to the fans, the people who the media would ultimately be reporting to, you can just do it yourself. The question of why do we need E3, I think, is interesting now, because I'm not really sure that we do.
Yeah.
But I think things like the PAX events and GDC, Gamescom, the Tokyo Game Show, I'm sure is like very fan focused as well. I think the things like that are good because it gives back to the fans, doesn't it? These are ultimately the people who are putting money in your wallet, you know what I mean? And buying your games, and are really the most important people in the marketing cycle. So yeah, I think that they're important to give back. I think they're important to give back to the gamers who love your games and are dedicated enough that they would travel to a big conference for you. I don't really think that they are necessary anymore for marketing.
Yep.
Having said that, I do love a bit of hype, Lewis. I do love a bit of hype.
Yeah, I think that's where the central tension for me comes in, because I think you're totally right. Thinking about attending something like Gamescom, like traveling to Germany, getting into the space, getting your hands on controllers, you know, you've got representatives from the companies there, they're going to be telling you about the games. I think the key thing there, though, is like, generally speaking, they're all games that you're kind of aware of already, right? By and large, they're games that you know are coming out, they're coming out in the next few months, you know you're going to get to see them there and you're going to get your hands on them. And I think all that is great. I think where you start to run into problems, and what we keep seeing actually in video gaming, is that this big old hype machine, this crazy thing that is like, we've got to crank out these massive reveals. All of the conference kind of floor shows at E3 are all about like, how much can we wow people, how many surprises can we throw in? And actually so much of that is just not actually achievable anymore. It's in the age of leaks, in the age of Reddit.
Yeah.
I feel like so much of games marketing cycles are kind of torpedoed by what we find out in advance, and maybe things have to change.
I think that this is especially true of Ubisoft the past 2 years, where I think that it was Watch Dogs Legion was leaked last year, and then the year before that it was Assassin's Creed that had leaked.
Yep.
And these were supposed to be like their big finishes, and they both just fell so flat because we already knew so much about the games going in. So I do completely understand that.
Yeah, it becomes a real shame for companies like that, like Ubisoft, that they put all this work in and they try to release it to us and we already know about it. And then everything kind of comes with caveats and questions. It's quite hard, I find at least, to get really excited about games that you've kind of had essentially revealed to you in advance, right?
No, I agree. I mean, there's no doubt about it. If information about a game is leaked beforehand, it deflates the moment. Of course it does. It does.
And just that whole thing about having like E3 floor show type things, to me these days, one, an admission from me, I find most of that really actually quite cringy at times. I find some of the conference shows, particularly at E3, like if you watched it from the perspective of someone who isn't invested in video games, I think you'd kind of think that they're not always great productions. I mean, they're definitely just not always great productions, right? And when they go well, they can be done really well. But in this day and age, like for everything that we get out of those, it's just the trailers, right? You just want the trailers and the gameplay stuff to be shown, and you just need the internet for that. And then
this is why, even though Nintendo does appear at E3 and they have big booths and they're a big presence on that floor.
Yeah.
In reality, their show is just a long direct.
Yep.
That's all it is.
Basically,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just a pre-recorded slideshow. That's what I would like to see PlayStation doing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I love E3. Like, I really do like E3. I love that we get all these announcements all at the one time, this big crescendo of all the stuff that's happening in video games, and that all happens all at the one time, and it's very, very exciting for that weekend, and it's awesome, and I really, really do like it. But from PlayStation's point of view, from Microsoft's point of view, from EA's point of view, from Nintendo's point of view, I completely, completely understand why they're just like, we don't need this at all.
Mm-hmm.
We do not need this at all. We can have our own events, whether it be like a PSX, and whether or not PlayStation bring that back, or some other experience that you're having with your fans, whether it be at some of the PAX events or GDC or whatever it is. I know GDC is more for game developers, you're getting what I mean. E3 must be just such a colossal drain just to be there at all. And what do you get out of it? I mean, I think that of everyone that had a major show at E3 last year, I think every single one of their stocks dropped after the presentation.
God.
I know that PlayStation.
Yeah.
Not last year, the year before.
Yeah.
The last year that PlayStation was there. And I thought PlayStation, like, by and large, had quite a good showing.
Yeah.
I know that it was a bit odd for the people who were there because they were, like, getting transported about the place. But for us watching at home, I actually thought it was quite good.
It was a series of trailers. It was great.
It was really, really good. Despite that, despite everyone basically being quite positive about it, or certainly I felt positive about it at the time, Sony's share price has still dropped. Yeah. So if I'm a business mind, I'm going, well, we spent all this money doing this fantastic showcase and our share prices fell.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we doing this?
Yeah.
we are spending a shit ton of money to, on an annual basis, make our company less valuable.
Yep. I mean, that's such a vital part to this whole question, right? Because I agree, like, I can't see why any of these companies would continue to invest long term in something like that. Not just that it affects their share price, right, but just the fact that you make a series of announcements, you know, it must cost a fortune. Think about Ubisoft's show last year, right? They took over a theatre, they brought celebrities on stage, they had all sorts of well-known people in the games industry there. There must have been so much around all of that. They've put so much money into that. Most of their announcements were spoiled in advance. Their biggest game, a lot of people were questioning whether it could actually pull off what they were saying it was. So on the back of that, if I was in charge of Ubisoft, I'd be sat there going, like, shouldn't we have just put all this onto YouTube and just forgot about that? And we could have used all that money there to host an event in Paris and invite people in to play, you know? I wonder if that's the direction we're going. And it felt a bit like that's what Jeff Keighley's statement was, right? Like,
yeah. I mean, Paris Games Week, I mean, is one of the other big...
Yeah.
Other big conferences for gaming in the world. Mm. And they are right there, you know? I don't know why they couldn't have just done something like that. And as you were getting at there, Jeff Keighley has said that we need to get more global, whether that means we have more announcements throughout the year, not just all building up at E3, and we spread them out among these other conferences that are much more fan focused and it's much more directly towards the fans rather than what E3 used to be anyway, which was basically directed towards the media.
Yep. And that's a really key point, because E3 was always directed to the media, right? But the media has completely changed. The media landscape is completely different, particularly in the gaming space, where in these days things like podcasts and, you know, online blogs and
hello
and video content and all that kind of thing, that's doing the work that those magazines used to. I just don't know where any of those old, like, conventional sort of media presences sit, and now really is it more important for a game publisher to reach to the influencers and the podcasters and all that kind of thing, because that can really amplify what your game is about really far and wide? Or is it better just to get one absolutely cracking trailer and put that out?
I honestly don't know, because obviously what E3's trying to do now is to get those influencers involved, because they are, from their perspective, a cheap way of getting the message out to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people these days as well would much rather hear the information that you would be given at E3 through their favourite influencer, their favourite YouTuber, their favourite Twitch streamer, rather than read an article on IGN or whatever, you know?
Well, and more than that, so, like, that's...
In that way, is sort of everyone's winning.
Yeah.
The only person that seems to be losing out of that is E3, because it's not what E3 was. It's not what we have as a vision for E3 in our minds. It's a totally different event. It's a totally different thing at that point, you know?
But it just doesn't seem like the old version of it, or, you know, to a certain extent, the current version of it, is really what the media itself even wants these days. And I think, going back to what you just said there, like, that idea that we want this information from third parties, basically, right? I don't necessarily take, you know, as it was a couple of years ago, Sean Layden coming up on stage and telling me how great PlayStation's games are. I don't necessarily take that at face value, because he's getting paid to say that. He has to say that.
Yeah, he's not going to come up there and say, do you know what? The new Last of Us is a really shit game. We really dropped the ball on it.
Yeah.
Enjoy.
Yeah, watch our share price tumble. But there's something there about, like, these days we're all so savvy, and we have to make constant decisions about what we choose to get excited about and what we choose to spend money on. It just feels like all that old order is kind of falling away, and that, you know, to come back to the conference part of it, it feels like they're to some extent like bastions of an old version of how to do all this. But I think you're right that the fan focus thing is probably the key, and if we can get more of that. I mean,
because the problem with E3 now is that it's trying to be this awkward hybrid thing where it's trying to be a media event, but the fans are there, which is pissing off
the media.
and then the fans also aren't having a very good experience, because it's not a fan focused event.
Exactly.
So it's sort of the worst of both worlds coming together at E3 just now. And that on top of the fact that all the publishers that are putting these amazing stage shows on, or not amazing stage shows on if you're listening to Illis, are even questioning whether or not they should bother turning up.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it seems to be on all fronts, E3 is waning. But at the same time, things like Gamescom are as big as they've ever been.
Yeah, it's growing and growing, yeah. I'm really struck as well by that promise that Stadia made, is punting this idea with Stadia that you could send someone a link to a game and they could jump in exactly where you've put them, right?
Yeah, and that was precise instance.
That was the word I was looking for. Yeah, there's something about that. Thinking again about how Nintendo behaves at E3, where they have their essentially their long direct, but they also have the kind of treehouse thing where they just do videos of people.
And reviews and stuff like that, and then people like actually hands on
playing game. It's usually like
that's great. Actually,
yeah, and it's like here's an hour of Animal Crossing, here's an hour of Pokemon or whatever. The idea that in future, when it gets beyond Stadia, when an idea like that is prevalent in the next gen, which it probably will be, that on a stage at E3, so to speak, someone could just be like, here's the link, you can click on this right now on your screen, or you can go to it on your PlayStation or whatever, and you can play the demo that we are would otherwise be showing you, or that we're about to show you, or that the press have played. There's always that thing that the press have played all these like Last of Us demos already before the delay happened. They can just give us that now, because it used to be like
one of the things about PAX East was that the fans were supposed to be getting their hands on the Last of Us for the first time, and now PlayStation aren't going to be there.
But
you're right, the press have played The Last of Us numerous times, but at the same time, like, that comes with another side to it as well.
Expectation management,
because a lot of those demos that the press have played would have been alphas or maybe slightly better than that, and they would have been a very vertical slice of what the game actually is, and the press who would have been familiar with playing a lot of things like this would understand what would be good and bad and what is fixable and what is not, whereas if you gave that just to a fan on the street, they would be like, your game is shit.
Yeah, I'm never buying it. That's totally true. But if we got to a state where a couple of months before release, that's how cinema does it, right? Like, cinema tends, you know about a project years in advance, right? Like, they've just started filming this new Batman film here in Glasgow. We've all seen photos of it already. But when those trailers start to hit, it will be like a couple of months away, and you can get really into that hype cycle then. And I love the idea that in future, you know, you could be watching your Nintendo Direct. I don't know why I keep coming back to Nintendo on this, because they're the least likely to do any of this. But you
something
can,
with online links. Behave yourself.
Imagine a future. Well, yeah, you're
watching links they know are in Zelda games. Whoa!
God, nailed terrible. It. That you're watching.
I'm going home. That's
you're watching your Direct on your laptop screen, and it just comes up and says, like, you know, this game, this new Zelda game is coming out in 3 months' time. Click this link right now. It'll boot up on your Switch, and you can play, you know, the first 15 minutes of the game. And it's, you know, because you're only a few months out from release, it's like nice and polished or whatever. It's still, you can still put it out
exactly.
As
so it's
whatever,
just like the 15 minute vertical slice, you know what I mean? And you can just make that 15 minutes like really polished.
Yeah. Or, and as soon as that technology becomes like possible, I think that that's where we'll be headed, because suddenly you don't need a lot of this other stuff and you can go directly into people's living rooms and you don't have to ask them all to come to Cologne or whatever, you know?
Yeah. Couldn't agree more with you there, Lewis. But with that, I have to remind everyone that you can find Players Too on all the social media. That's Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, the lot. You can also find our written content over at PlayersToo.com. That's PlayersToo.com. And if you could take 5 seconds to give us 5 stars over on Apple Podcasts, that really, really helps us out. I know we say it every week, and I know every podcast says it, but it really, really does help us out. It does a huge amount for the exposure of the show, and thank you so much to anyone that's already done that. And while you're over there giving us 5 stars, if you leave us a review as well, let us know, and we'll give you a shout out on social media. And again, just thanks so much for taking the time. It really does mean a lot to us. I'd like to remind everyone that our play-along game for this month is Kentucky Route Zero. We have both started Kentucky Route Zero. I have many thoughts already, and I'm not even finished.
Good.
So I think that'll be a really interesting discussion next week.
I can't wait.
Really?
Yeah. I've played chapter one. I think you're a bit further ahead.
Chapter three.
Yeah. And I have a lot of thoughts. And just a lot, and more than thoughts, I have a lot of feelings, Mark. It left me with some feels.
I know. So it does get you in the feels.
It gets
a bit,
you in the
old
feels, yeah.
All right. Well, we'll catch you next week when we discuss our feelings and Kentucky Route Zero. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see you later.
Thanks.